Hello, Simon. How are you?
Hi, Claudio. Hi. Great. I mean, seeing all this audience here, it's pretty wide. It's hard to address everybody in such a room. So good to be here in Bucharest after a while.
Every year, SAP announces key messages for the year. I think it is important for all the audience gathered together, which is formed by managers, CTOs, and entrepreneurs, to know what are the key messages for this year, in your opinion, Simon?
So key messages, as far as I was able to follow this nice presentation in Romanian, I could identify a couple of words. So basically, Dragos already caught some of the key topics. It's all about digital economy. It's about how SAP can serve companies to adopt, embrace digital economy, and how can they survive in this digital economy. I caught the name Nokia. Yeah? I guess it was all about how to somehow transfer, you know, your business from being a top leader basically down to zero. But there is another example.
Kodak. Like,
exactly, Kodak. Can you imagine, you know, being in the business where you actually own the market? I believe Kodak used to have a little bit less than 90% of market share, and then suddenly this business disappeared. So this is also impact of digital economy. And what we would like to emphasize basically is that companies need to be ready. It's not about whether this is coming or not. It's only about when it's coming. And what we would like to emphasize is basically that your companies and yourselves are ready for next big thing, which is going on already now.
We are different here. We are acting in distinct industries, and we have a different perception about digital transformation. What it is your opinion about digital transformation? What is your personal definition of it?
So, first of all, it's not about IT. Don't get me wrong. Digital economy and digital transformation is about transforming your business. And maybe let me give you a couple of background what is going on these days. I guess most of you already heard about these mega trends. Yeah? Data is being doubled every 18 months. We have all these social networks. Everything goes mobile. Internet of Things. Everything gets connected. I mean, just ask yourself how many sensors do you have today, these smart wristbands, Apple Watch, whatever. And then think about who is actually your client tomorrow. There are many studies going on these days, and by 2020, the prevailing workforce will be millennials. I guess you know who are millennials. So. And then think about how these millennials who were born into digital economy already, how do they perceive environment? How do they consume goods and services? And then think about these millennials who basically don't even use emails no more because this is offline, outdated technology. And then, you know, these millennials are becoming your clients, your colleagues, your bosses, your suppliers. And basically, since they are used to technology which are born to being on social networks, using mobile devices. Think about how you are going to be able to sell some services and goods to these people. How you are going to attract these talents as a company. How you are going to treat them as your suppliers. So it's a mental and philosophical change in the whole business concept.
So you create your strategy looking at the millennials. It's interesting. Do you have any advice for me? For example, I work in media, and how could I adopt this strategy?
Absolutely, absolutely good case, because also think about how your business changed in the last couple of years. So basically, your readers became your contributors. Think about how you engage with all these people on I don't know, social networks, web, or whatever. So they are contributing with the content. Maybe. Question from my end, how many or how much of your content is being somehow generated from your readers?
Unfortunately, a little bit.
A little bit, but it's getting more and more, I would say. Yeah? So it's a big shift. And of course, you need to address all these readers, subscribers, via different channels. Yeah? Somebody are using still webs, somebody access you over social media, somebody might be reading, you know, on mobile phones. I would say next thing is, you know, to take a glance at the news on smartwatches and so on. So the change is kicking in big time. Yeah?
Which countries are adopting this trend of digital transformation the fastest? Can you distinguish between old and new economy, in your opinion?
Well, yes. Maybe the good example is maybe Spain and Italy. For example, a couple of years ago, these two countries were hit by economical crisis big time. And basically, they were forced to come with new ideas, with new business models. And when I'm talking about new business models, we need to think about servicizing products, for example. I will give you a couple of examples. For example, Rolls-Royce. You know that Rolls-Royce is one of the biggest producer of airplane engines. They are no longer selling engines as product, but they are rather providing services. So basically, aircraft producers, they rent services from Rolls-Royce. They do not own the engine, meaning that all the maintenance, all predictive analytics, everything is done by Rolls-Royce, and airplane companies is actually paying for services. Next good example is one company, Kaiser Compressors, for example. This company used to produce air compressors. So from the small one, you can fit in your garage, and you know, having all these big compressors supplying big factories for all these pneumatical tools. They were hit heavily by tough competition coming from China. You can imagine, price war started. This was, by the way, a German company. And basically, we somehow teamed up with this company, and we started to think about, actually, what is their value? So what they are providing with? And at the end, I mean, the answer is very simple. This company is supplying you with compressed air. Yeah? So then we somehow shift the mindset, and we said, OK, why not to sell compressed air? Why do we sell compressors? And believe it or not, so they changed the business model big time, completely. And within 1 year, this company came up to $1 billion, or yeah, it was US dollars, of turnover. So this is a transformation. This is digital transformation. I mean, yes, of course, IT is needed. IT is needed as a platform who is enabling this transformation. But at the end, is business idea. And the benefit, basically, of this is that from the business point of view, there is a moment in time you can simply say, IT enables everything. You don't need to think about any obstacles anymore. Yeah?
Do you think this trend of servicizing the products will continue next year?
Absolutely.
In what industry?
I would say all over the industries. I mean, there are many service focused industries already, but for example, I would say traditional manufacturing companies. I will give you one more example, which is absolutely crazy if you ask me. I guess everybody heard about connected cars. Yeah? So today there is a bunch of cars which are already connected to some services, like BMW. SAP teamed up with BMW a couple of years ago with a project called Connected Drive. Where we simply provide a lot of services for the driver driving BMW. There is one company, I'm not allowed to name it, who is thinking about the following. So, and by the way, this is producers of the sport cars. Yeah? So most of the cars today physically have the same engine. It's about electronics who controls the torque, the brake horsepowers, you know, the maximum speed, acceleration, and so on. And they started to think about, what about if you download, I don't know, additional 100 horsepowers for weekend to go on the track to race a little bit, why would you buy premium sports car with, I don't know, 400 horsepowers? Because during the work week, you don't need all this capacity because you are stuck in the heavy traffic, like here in Bucharest, for example. But you know, then Saturday, Sunday, you just download the package of additional 100 horsepower, and you pay for services. Yeah? So this is absolutely fantastic. I mean, you know, something like that was not even possible, or nobody was thinking about 2 years ago. But now this is reality. Yeah? So this is typical example how traditional producer of goods, in that particular case cars, is thinking about services. I met one executive coming from BMW who basically told me, I mean, we are no longer car manufacturer. We are becoming mobile software company. This is, I mean, think about it. Huh?
This is a strong, deep digital transformation. So if this digital transformation is such an opportunity now, what should the companies gather to today should do, yeah, starting from today?
First of all, you need to simplify your business. There was one video at the beginning, I don't know whether everybody saw it. 40 years ago, SAP somehow introduced business processes. Why? Because business got complex and more complex, and basically in order to set up sustainable growth platform, we simply had to introduce the processes. But you know, while these businesses were growing, we were somehow adding up these processes on the pile. You know, more business, additional processes. Again, more business, some more processes. And we came to the situation where we simply stuck with the processes. So now we admit, you know, that we also, while we introduced the processes, we were also a good or big contributor to this complication in a way. First step is simplify your business and simplify your environment, but then put your client in the middle or center of the universe, because it's all about how do you address your client, which channels do you use to address your client. Think about what is connected around, Internet of Things, all the assets, and then reimagine your business, how it's going to look like from tomorrow on.
Who should be in charge with this process, in your opinion? The CEO, the CTO?
Well, I believe that the role of CIO, and I hope I won't be, you know, punished or kicked when I go out, but the role of CIO will change big time. Because, and again, this might be my really personal opinion, but I see that traditional IT is somehow splitting in two ways. Many things will simply become infrastructure, commodity. Yeah? Think about when electricity was invented more than 100 years ago. Everybody was talking about electricity, voltage, current, and so on. Does somebody think about electricity today? No. It is just there. You just plug in your device. Okay, it's full commodity. And big part of IT business will become commodity. Yeah. Second part will go into more, I would say, digital office. I can see a lot of companies who are already introducing the role of chief digital officer. So in my view, this is more business role than IT role, because IT needs to follow the business. Of course, I'm not neglecting the importance of IT, because it's utmost important, but the way how you create all business environment around your client, this is the key. And to think about how to address the client, this is the role of chief digital officer in a way. Of course, he needs to have, or she needs to have, a budget.
It's important, this. How about a chief innovation officer in the organization?
As well, definition of innovation is really broad, because you can innovate the way how you address client, you can innovate the way how you set up your business environment, the way how you set up your IT environment at the end. So I believe that innovation is actually the blood of future of the companies, and there are many different business models, you know, how to put this role. First of all, I believe there are many companies who are doing mistake while separating this role of innovation, because for me innovation actually is a mainstream, and when we talk about innovation, we really need to somehow cover end-to-end process. So the way how we innovate the business models, but of course also the way how we going to support this transformation to new business models. So somebody have this role mixed. Somebody call it even chief technology officer, or chief digital officer. It's more naming convention, but it's a very important role, I would agree.
Because of your position, you have a broader perspective about the region. How do you see companies in this respect of digital transformation?
If you would ask me this question 1 year ago, my answer would be, I mean, CE is always, I would say, a little bit more conservative environment. When we compare ourselves with, I don't know, United States, more developed Western European countries, we are always a little bit behind. But now I'm really happy to confirm that we have so many early adopters. I mean, believe it or not, I cannot disclose absolute numbers, but if you ask me how our business relates to digital economy, I can tell you 30% of our business is already directly or indirectly connected with digital transformation. Talking to some of business analysts like Ernst Young or Deloitte or Boston Consulting Group, they are predicting that 65% of their total business in 2016 will be associated with digital transformation. This is a really strong signal. And usually these guys are not wrong, especially when they are forecasting only 1 year in advance. So 65% of their business is going to be associated with digital economy. I believe this is absolutely great signal for all these countries in, inside Central and Eastern Europe, but also an early warning for us leaders who somehow need to shape strategy of our companies.
How about Romanian companies? What is the level of digital adoption in Romania?
Let me start with the question. So, can you raise your hand in the audience? Who do you believe in cloud? Only SAP people, or what? you need to believe professionally, I know. But for example, yesterday I landed at the Bucharest airport and I saw many people ordering taxis via mobile phones, paying with mobile phones, for example. This is all cloud. How many of you are using Gmail? Oh, great. And you are telling me you don't believe in cloud. Come on, guys. So coming back to Romania, I believe you are really entrepreneurial environment. And I'm not talking just empty words. For example, we are doing a global initiative to support startups, providing them with HANA Cloud Platform.
What is the status now? What is the feedback from entrepreneurs?
Absolutely fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. One deviation of this program is about to happen in November in Sofia, in Bulgaria. We had 70 applicants coming from all Central and Eastern Europe, and 20 are coming from Romania. Yeah, so you know, this is great success. I mean, and it shows that you guys are really entrepreneurial. And I hope next time when I ask you how many of you believe in cloud, everybody is raising the hand, because all this development, all these 20 startups, I can tell you they are building nice applications and solutions, of course, in the cloud. And cloud, we'll be talking about cloud maybe next 2 years, because after that, this is only one of delivery methods. Yeah? And it really doesn't matter. We might be talking about this paranoia, whether our data is secured, you know, where our data is sitting. But considering that basically everybody is using Gmail today, do you ask yourself where your email is actually sitting? Yeah? No, I guess not. Otherwise, nobody would use it, because you need to understand that your data is secured. You need to understand, for example, what are SLAs, that reliability of accessing your data is high enough, and full stop.
But I have a big but here, because at a macro level, I'm looking at two indexes, DESI, Digital Economic Societal Index, and Innovation Barometer. Yeah. We are the worst performer as a country. Do you see this as an opportunity or as a threat for Romania, for Romanian companies?
I see only opportunities. And precisely this situation, when I saw such a big ratio coming from Romanian young people addressing this startup program, I see big hope and big opportunity. And actually, I am challenging you, because I see, you know, in this group, we are a little bit less younger than these guys who are applying for this startup event. Come on, let's be bold. Let's think about bold moves. Everybody, you know, when you come home tonight, think about what are the bold moves you are going to run for your companies. and you will help the whole environment actually being perceived more innovative. Huh? Let's do it. Why not? And honestly, you know, the boundaries, when we talk about business, when we talk about new business models, it doesn't really matter whether you are doing business in Romania or in Germany, yeah? Because it's becoming global, it's becoming online, and companies or clients, when they are buying services and products, I can tell you, they less and less care what is the origin of these products or services. They care about the quality, they care about usability, easy to use. If you ask somebody who is now 20 years old, you know, what brand of watch or what brand of car these young people would like to drive, they don't care. They want to drive. Yeah, they want to get from point A to point B as efficient as possible. They want to look at, you know, some device to check the time, but that's all about. So this attachment to brands, of course, we have some examples which are more cultural than all, but it's getting less and less important. It's about the level or in quality of services we provide to these people. And I can tell you, this is great, great opportunity for Romania. Although you are a big nation of 20 million plus, but your playground is global. It's not only 20 million.
In this context, what else can we expect from SAP in the near future, Simon?
I mean, first of all, we are committed to continue with our innovation. Yesterday we had a discussion, for example, SAP 5-6 years ago was perceived pretty much as an ERP company. Yeah? We changed completely. We didn't invent digital transformation, but we perfectly know where this digital economy is going, and we can really help your business to evolve.